Okay, I restart just for the people at home. Sorry for the repetition here. So there are two layers of fluid. One is the pink one, which is light. Blue is the heaviest fluid. Now the lady is going to flip the container, and the red and the heaviest fluid is going to slide in this direction, and the pink one is going to slide upward. Therefore, there is going to be a shear velocity that is happening at the boundary, and this is going to create an instability which is called Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. So let's see. Now she's unscrewed the system, and boom. You see that the fluid is sliding. You see that here there is a little bit lifted. It means that the fluid is going down at the bottom. And at this point, you see still very initial moments, an instability starting to arise. Just go a little bit backward. You see that there are these tiny wiggles that are starting to form. That's the scenario that we are treating in the mathematics that we are going to use, so perturbative approach. The perturbations are still very small. Then, as I was telling to your colleague here in the lecture room, to study the further development, we need, for example, numerical simulations that allow us to deal with the complexity of all the phenomena that are taking place in the fluid, and I'm going to show you this as well. Let's continue the run. So here, the lady is looking, boom. Have you seen how fast it went? Look what a mess now. So let's do it again. So we start from tiny perturbation, the two fluids start to slide, and then boom, at a certain point, boom. You see? Then the lady say, oh, what do you think? And then the guy say, whoa. He's very impressed, and he's nodding. And the guy is always, this guy has no reaction at all. So here is a slow motion of a zoom in. You can see that the instability that is taking place. You see how it's growing, so it's very slow motion, and it creates these periodic wiggles that are the remnants of the oscillations in the initial solution that we are used in our perturbative approach. And then you see that the coherent flow, because this is still a coherent flow, because you can see clear shapes, at a certain point it degrades into turbulence. You see? Then everything gets mixed up. So from large scales, turbulence arises and it goes to small scales. To show you how how the computations are done with this complex scenario, I'll show you a numerical simulation. In this case, we have the yellow fluid that is moving on the right side, if I'm correct, with respect to the blue ones. Okay? So again, we have a shear flow, in this case, on the top and on the bottom of the yellow material. So you can imagine like a stream of wind in the air that can be on Earth or on Jupiter, for instance. Or you can imagine a jet which is going across a medium which is not moving with respect to the yellow band, which might be the center of our jet. So let's run our simulation. So these are hydrodynamics applied on small cells. And boom, you see the explosion of the wiggles. Look, then it grows, it grows, it grows, it grows, it grows. This is as a time scale, is like the slow motion that we have seen before. And now here it's nice because you can see how the computation is done. You see that we are zooming in, zooming in, zooming in, and we are looking at a tiny detail of our fluid. And you see that this has been done, this is a numerical computation done with the computer, in which the volumes of the fluid have been split in different cells, and for each of these cells it has been computed with the hydrodynamical equations that we have seen, the pressure, the velocity, the density. Okay? If you would have also tracked what was the temperature evolution of the fluid, then we would have also had to solve the energy conservation for the cells. Okay? And you see that the cells have not all the same size. This is a meshed grid. So whenever you have more details are needed to describe, for example, the bending of these wiggles, then you need the tiner cells so that you can have better pixels to see what's going on. If the distribution in velocities and in temperature is quite uniform, then larger cells are sufficient. And this is done just for a matter of saving computational time. Okay? Just show you the beginning again. You start with nothing. The time is slowing, and boom, at a certain point, you have the exponential growth of the wiggles. Okay? Again, what we are studying with our formalism, if you want to go away, is just up to here. You don't see it, but there are tiny waves over the surface. That's up to the point that we know. Then with our solution, we know that this mess is going to happen. We have another instability that we are going to study, and that's Rayleigh-Taylor instability. Again, this is an experiment in which we have we have gravity in this case, and we have a layer of so this case, this can also happen without gravity. You just have two sliding layers of fluid, and then all of this is going to happen. In this case, we need gravity, and we have a bottom layer of a lighter fluid, and on top we have an heavier one, which is the case of the pendulum, which is standing vertical. Okay? And to implement in a real world this scenario, they have a metal surface that is separating the two, and then they slide it away in such a way that the two fluids are in contact, and then the instability arises. Look. Blah, blah, blah. Okay. So here you see this is a tank full of clear water, and then there is a lighter fluid at the bottom. Perhaps they put salt in water. Okay, so that is lighter. And then they slide this metal protection away. So you see that at the very initial instant, the two fluids are, what's going to happen? Okay, and they are still one next to each other without moving much. But then the instability kicks in, and boom, all the mess is going to take place. And that's how it goes. You see, you have these mushrooms that are going to basically move upward. And if you look at the beginning here, you can see the wiggles. You can see the ups and down of our solution, okay? Which x component in exponential describes the shape and and the velocity with which these waves might also propagate in some direction. And it gives you the time evolution. And you see the mushrooms, for example, look at this one, that is moving upward. Or if you wish, you can also think at the heaviest fluid that is sinking down. So it sinks and pushes the other one upward. So the two things are working together because you have the tight connection between the two fluids. Okay? And I think I have a simulation. That's the same case, two fluids. The time is running, nothing is happening, and then at a certain point, boom. That's what's going to happen. This is how you solve hydrodynamics with the computer. This is a simulation that represents what happened before in the experiments that we have seen. Okay? Good. Then there are also thermal instabilities that needs a model which is slightly different. And in this case, we have our fluid, which has an average temperature in blue, And the bottom is basically heating up the container. Again, this is a simulation. And what it means, you see that there is a gradient in temperature because the bottom is heating up the pot, basically, like when you are at home. The bottom layer is hotter, and then we have a colder layer over it. And you are going to see the instability, boom, that kicks in. Look, it's kind of stable at the beginning. You see the gradient is growing. You see that the bluish part is going upward, okay? But you still keep the layers separated. But then at a certain point, boom, you have the instability, and the instability grows, and grows. And you may recognize this pattern, because if you look, for example, your pot, you're boiling water when you're cooking, you will see that there are the bubbles that are coming out from pots, and you will see the convective layer that are responsible for the heat up of the pot, even, and it's, you see, it's in spot, even though you are heating, your source of heat is kind of uniform. In this case, it was perfectly uniform, but these instabilities arise and give this sort of shape. Case of astronomical interest is, for example, this one, in which this is actually a magnetohydrodynamics. So we're going as well to study magnetohydrodynamics. So these are fluids, these are plasmas. So we're going to study the behavior of charged plasma. But nevertheless, I want to show you what's happening here, in which you have the magnetic field, which is kind of creating a barrier. You have the solar wind shining upon Jupiter or the Earth, or choose an object that has a magnetic field. And then you have basically the cosmic wind that is, the solar wind that is going to kind of slide along the surface of the gas surrounding the planet. Okay, therefore you are kind of a gas which is static. It arrives, the wind, it slides upon the surface, so it kind of slides in this direction, and you have the insurgence of the Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. If you look at Jupiter, you can see the wind in Jupiter. You have different bends in the atmosphere. You have some material that is sliding in this direction. This one is sliding in the opposite direction, and you see the wiggles and the curves and the tides that are developed because of the Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. Of course, you see it's kind of a messy scenario, because it's not a perfect ideal case like in the simulation or the example on the experiments, lab experiments that we have seen so far. But still, the nature of the development of this instability is the very same. We can look, for example, at the formation of planets. This is, again, a simple simulation. This is the formation, this is the disk over which planets form. So you have the central star. The material is arranged in a torus around the central star. It is each particle and molecule and atom that is constituting this gas is spinning around the central object, following Keplerian motions. And you know that there are gradients in velocities, because if you have an object that is closer to the center with respect to an object which is far away with respect to the center, the one closer to the center is moving faster with respect to the central one. And this creates shear velocities. So you have different layers, if you look at shells, at different radii that are moving with different velocities. And this creates Kelvin-Helmholtz instability that we are going to see here. You see, there are the wiggles. Time is passing. And then the wiggles will become larger and larger. The density, you see, it's now starting to have this wavy pattern. There are ups and downs. And then at a certain point, they will get larger and larger. And you see what's happening is that you have these, the wiggles, and there are over density, so this is tracing density. You see that there is the formation of knots. You see the waves grows, the knots get larger and larger. They can disappear, they can be dissipated, they can reform, and so on. It is influence the formation of planetesimal. Planetesimal that forms, you have your your rocks. You can see now better the waves when they become non-linear. They then can merge together to form larger planets. Okay? So you see as well how this can be useful for the study of the formation of planets, for instance. And we move on, and so on. You see the formation of planetesimal that is pushed by the formation by the Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. Last case, let's take a jet. So now look only at this panel here. This is again a simple simulation in which we have a uniform medium, so imagine a cloud of gas with constant pressure, density, and whatever, and which is not moving. And there is a jet. So imagine, for example, a black hole. It's starting its production. It's starting to accrete material, production of magnetic field, and boom, two jets are produced, and the jet is moving in this direction, for example, within the intergalactic medium. Okay? So let's see what's going to happen. Boom, Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. You see here, it gets completely non-linear, so it gets completely crazy. But if you look at the entrance of the jet into the medium, where we are still in the nearly linear regime, you can see the wiggles that then become non-linear waves. So they escape the regime that we are considering at the moment. So we are basically studying just the insurgence of these instabilities. And then we have the mixing up of the material of the jet with the surrounding environment. Okay? You can see that it's not quite an astrophysical scenario here, because is a closed box, but you see that the fluid is kind of captured by the box, so it would escape. So in an astrophysical scenario there would be the formation of a longer jet, but that's basically the same evolution that we expect for up to this point. It's quite well representative of an astrophysical jet. Maybe coming from a black hole, maybe coming from a forming star, and so on and so forth. Okay? So these are the instabilities that we are going to consider. Kelvin Helmholtz, Rayleigh-Taylor, and thermal instability. Okay, now that we know how it goes, let's go back to our equations. So we have our perturbative approach. We are using to obtain linear differential equations. Then we go into the Fourier space, meaning we are employing wave solutions as composed by superposition of wave functions. And then to obtain algebraic equations. And then now we are going to use some approximation, some assumption about the fluid that we are considering. Which is, for example, no viscosity. So for an ideal gas. We are going to consider the case of an uncompressible fluid. Which means that the gradient of the density is equal to zero, as well the gradient of the velocity is equal to zero. Wait, I have to work again on the video, sorry. Because I have to point the camera to the blackboard. Okay, here we are. And then what we we move our focus on the part of the equations of the solution that we care about, which is not the background solution that we assume to be known. For example, what is the velocity of one of the components of the fluid that we have seen, but we just look what are the perturbations around the unperturbed solution. Therefore, we shift in the frame of the background solution. Does it mean that we have the velocity, which is equal, using the perturbative approach that we've seen, as the velocity of our background solution, plus the change of velocity, and we just move in the rest frame of, so this is the velocity of the fluid, we just move to the rest frame of the background solution. Therefore, these two guys cancel out, and we are left with the little perturbation. Remember that when you have this dV, the rho, the pressure, this is not a derivative, but just mean small velocity. And in this case, for simplicity, I'm just, to make the notation a little bit simpler, whenever you look for dV, sorry, for V, I mean the perturbation, okay? Just keep this in mind. So from now on, when you see V, it means that I'm just looking for the perturbation because we moved in the rest frame. Good. First of all, let's look at the evolution of the vorticity. So that we have a complete picture that is arising from this approximation. And from the previous lecture, we know that in the case of an ideal fluid, we have that the time evolution of the vorticity is equal to the curl of V cross omega plus 1 over rho. Of pressure. So, uncompressible fluid, this guy is equal to zero. This vanishes. So we are left only with this term. I can use the properties of the cross product now, because I have the cross product of a cross product. We know that this is equal to V, the gradient of omega, minus omega, the gradient of the velocity. But again, in compressible fluid, the gradient of the velocity is equal to zero. This drops. And that's, we know that for the ideal fluid, that's equal to zero. Okay? Therefore, the vorticity cannot grow. Can be present initially, but it cannot grow. And since we are dealing with instabilities, where we are going to have a very fast evolution of the velocities, we can basically neglect this term because it will become very fast negligible with respect to the other. Okay, well, the terms that are, this cannot grow, it's constant. The other one are going to grow exponentially if we have an instability. And therefore, all the contribution that is given by omega will become negligible in a very short time.
Again, it's obvious that this is equal to zero because we have the gradient of a curl which is equal to zero. Okay, as we have seen already in the previous lecture, I just wanted to stress it once more. Okay, then we are dealing with cases in which we have gravity, and for dealing with our fluid, we can use Bernoulli's equation. Bernoulli's law, which is in the case for scenario in which omega is equal to zero, we are neglecting it. So it's an irrotational fluid. And we can have that the velocity is different than zero. Okay? So it's a non-static case. And Bernoulli's law for this case is equal to the time evolution of the velocity potential plus v squared over 2 plus the contribution of the specific entropy plus the contribution of the gravitational of the potential energy given by gravity. Again, we consider Boulder condition at infinity in which this is equal to zero. Now, remember that the potential of the velocity is defined as way. So that's the scalar function which gradient is the velocity. Okay? So this is a definition. Good. Now, remember that we are using perturbation at first order, and remember that whenever you see V, we are talking about a small perturbation. Therefore, it is a small perturbation velocity at the power of 2, but this is second order. Therefore, we neglect the terms V squared. Okay, because remember that this is actually our perturbation. Then we have the velocity V that is equal to the gradient of the potential. We can now apply the gradient to this function such that we can have the gradient of the velocity equal to nabla square the potential, but this guy is equal to zero, right? Again, incompressible fluid. What does it mean? That's equal to zero. It means that the velocity potential is described by the Laplace equation. Then, as we did for the Bondi accretion, we need to specify which kind of fluid we are dealing with to have an explicit expression for the specific enthalpy. Therefore, we just assume to have so we just have our change in enthalpy. We know from the considerations that we've done in the previous lecture that's the relationship. Whenever you have your fluid, you plug in your equation of state that relates the pressure to the density. Okay. But in general, here we are dealing with an incompressible fluid. It means that rho is constant. Therefore, I can rewrite this equation. So I just make the integral of this equation. Rho plays the role of a constant. Therefore, I get the specific enthalpy is equal to P over rho. Right? This is a constant. and I make just the integral of the two guys on top. Because rho is constant. Having that, we can get our final solution. Well, it's not solution, but the final form of Bernoulli's equation. So the t phi is unchanged plus p over rho v squared. Terms with v squared disappeared. We are left with the specific enthalpy, which is this guy here, plus phi is equal to zero. And now what we do, we just isolate p from this equation. Therefore, we can relate the pressure to the density and the velocity through the velocity potential. So this is Bernoulli's law, reshuffled a bit. So now I give you a counterexample, if you wish, which is given by gravity waves, in which we are not going to have the insurgence of instabilities. But we have just instabilities in the sense that there are perturbations around the medium that are oscillating. Okay? They're not going to blow exponentially. Gravity waves. So what do we have? We have, in this case, the sea. So that's a very romantic scenario, in which we have the height that is given by z. We have a gas, the atmosphere, that has a certain pressure, P2, and this is constant. And then we have water, which is incompressible. We have G, that is playing like this, and our solution that we're going to study are plane waves, in which what we care about is the height of the wave. It can be positive or negative, okay? And we just characterize it by some function that depends on the position and time. Okay, so x is going this direction, and y is coming outside the blackboard. And L is the height. So that's the height as a function of position over the surface, over the background surface. Then we have the velocity along z, which is what we care about, because we want to see how the oscillations are proceeding, which is nothing but the derivative of L with respect to time, because L is the height, so that the time derivative is the velocity. Definition of the time of the total derivative, so we have the TL plus V gradient of L. But look what we have. Remember that V is the small perturbation, and therefore this term is going to be negligible with respect to this one. So we neglect it. It's not equal to zero, but it's very small with respect to the other term, because that's of the order of L, which is our solution, and V is negligible. We have Bernoulli, reshuffled in the way that I gave you there, that refers to the to the fluid minus rho delta t psi plus g l. Okay, so P is the pressure on the fluid. Okay, that's the fluid. The pressure exerted on the fluid is the one of the gas. Now what we do, we care about L, therefore we pull out this term of the equation. We have the minus, which is sitting here, minus G L is equal to P2 over rho plus delta T of the velocity potential. And I can use a trick here, because you see I have a time derivative here. I can express this guy as the time derivative of all of that. How can I do it? Well, P2 is constant, rho is constant, and therefore this is equal to dt P2 over rho times t plus dt of the potential. Right? These two are constant. The time derivative of a constant times the time is exactly that. But now, look, what a nice trick. I can put everything together, because everything is applied to the time operator, delta t. Therefore, we have P2 over rho t plus the velocity potential. Furthermore, remember that the gravitational potential, that the velocity, V, is defined as the gradient of the potential. Therefore, I have the freedom to change the potential with any constant I want, for every time. Therefore, I can as well write minus P2 over rho, and I would obtain exactly the same velocity. Okay, remember, given a time fixed, this is a constant, and I have the freedom to, which is valid through all, that has no dependency with respect to x, y, and z, for whenever I apply the gradient, this is going to vanish, and I'm left only with that, which is the original one, okay? If I do this transformation here, I can basically get rid of this constant here. So that's going to be equal to delta t psi prime, which is the one that I transform by subtracting the constant, okay? Let me drop the prime to avoid maybe confusion with derivatives and so on, okay? This is just the velocity potential that I have the freedom to shift with respect to a function which has no special dependency, and I get this relationship. Okay? Then I apply the time derivative to this equation. T of rho, of L. G is a constant, because that's the acceleration given by the planet over which we are considering the fluctuation of this fluid. And the only function is L, that has a time dependency, and therefore it goes there. What is L? That's actually the height, Z. Therefore, the time derivative of the height is what? Is the velocity along the Z direction. That's equal to, we know what is the relation to the gravitational potential, minus g gradient of the velocity potential. So what I did was to reshuffle this term in such a way that I have the velocity potential in such a way that I can find the solution for psi. Okay? We call it equation two. Then what we know from the previous result? We know that the velocity potential must obey, is obeying the Laplace equation. And we solve as well our solution for C in plane wave, as we said. So I'm exactly following the same structure that I described at the beginning. Therefore, we solve basically Laplace equation. Get the potential, which means to get the velocity. Right? In the end, we get the velocity if we solve for the velocity potential. And to solve it, we know that Laplace equation can be easily solved in plane waves. It's actually its solution. So we have some dependency of the shape as a function of z times the exponential that describes a plane wave. And the solution of the Laplace equation, I'm not going to make the derivation here because it's trivial, and actually we already did it during the course of the lecture. The solution is equal to some amplitude, some initial amplitude V0, e to the k z, and then we have the plane wave dependency. That's the solution of the Laplace equation. And what we care about, I'm using only the two solutions. I'm taking only the one with the plus here because I'm considering the water, okay? And therefore, it's the one for z smaller than zero. Then we combine our solution with this one. And what we get, so we have the z of the z. Yes, this is the z because it's the gradient. So we have the z of c. We plug in our solution that is coming from there. Therefore, that's the only the dependency with respect to z is here. There is no dependency here. Therefore, we have a k that is coming down. And then the derivative of the exponential itself. Therefore, this is going to be equal to kc. You see, we are going to Fourier space, if you wish, because you see derivative with respect to position are given by k, proportionality of k factor with the function, region function. Then we have the other side of the equation. We do the same. So we have minus 1 over rho, the t square of c, and we plug it into here. This gives us minus 1 over g minus I omega square c. In fact, look, I'm doing the double derivative of time of our solution. The only time dependency is this one. We have the minus I omega, which is coming down twice because I have a double derivative. So this gives us this minus I omega squared. I squared gives you minus. Minus times minus gives you the plus. The minus here, therefore, remains. Well, we have minus 1 over g omega square c. That gives you omega square equal to kg. And therefore, omega is equal to plus minus square root of kg. And this is real. equals K is positive, G is positive. There are no these terms of the exponential, so if we take only this term of the exponential, e to the minus I omega t, minus I omega t, this is real number and gives you oscillations. There is no insurgence of instabilities. You see, now in combining the equations, there are several steps that are taking place, but the concept is always the same. You start with your hydro simulation, from your hydro equations, Bernoulli's law, remember that is coming from the Poisson equation in case of an ideal fluid. So that's our hydro equation. We use a perturbative approach, and as well we take advantage of the fact that the velocity potential, given the conditions that we have seen, basically obeys Laplace equation. Therefore we have the hydro equation plus the constraint that we have on the velocity. We put them together, okay? And in the end, we look for the solution of the velocity potential, which is a direct reflection of the velocity. Therefore, we know what is going to be the velocity of the oscillations. And we aim at the derivation of the value of omega, because omega is the term that goes in your plane wave and tells you if there are going to be a runaway in your solution, if you're going to have an instability that is taking place, or if you're going to have periodic oscillations. In the next lecture, we are going to derive another instability, which is the Rayleigh-Taylor instability, which in the video was the one with the green fluid. That was lighter with respect to the fluid which was standing over it. And thinking at the pendulous, in the plane wave that we studied so far, in the gravity waves that we studied so far, we were considering a pendulum, right? Linear waves are oscillating like that. For the other case, we are basically flicking the scenario because we have the heaviest fluid on top of the light one, and this is an instability. That's the pendulum, which is standing vertically and is going to fall because initially in equilibrium, but the equilibrium is unstable and give rise to the motion of the fluid. So I just anticipate what I'm going to do the next lecture because the time is almost to the end. In which, as I said, we have the bottom, we have zero, z direction, that's the surface of our fluid, that's the x direction, we have rho 1, and then we have some velocity for this fluid, then we have rho 2, and then some velocity for this fluid as well, okay? And this is the boundary of the unperturbed solution. We have gravity, as in the experiment that we have seen so far. And this is the bottom of the container. This is the surface of the fluid. It can also be the surface of the container as well, because it is an incompressible fluid, and therefore it has a definite surface, it's not going to expand or contract. And we call it H1, this height, and minus H2, this height here. So the depth of our container. As we said, we are going to have the fluid obeying the very same laws that we applied before. So we have the Laplace equation for the fluid. We have Bernoulli's equation that we reshuffled and which properties were specified for our current fluid. And the potential is the gravitational potential, therefore is with respect to the zero surface. So if we have something going up or down, we need to look what is at the height with respect to the zero level. And therefore our potential phi is going to be Lg. G, where G is the acceleration, gravitational acceleration. Then I just give you the boundary conditions that are given by our scenario. At the boundary, we have that P1 minus P2 for Z equal to L, so given a certain height. These have to be equal to zero, because this is the interface between the two layers. They are in contact, therefore they have the same pressure. And something similar we have for the velocity, because we have the velocity of the component one. You see that's the Z component of the gradient, so this is the VZ for the fluid one, minus the Z of the fluid two at the border between the two fluids must be equal to zero, because they are in contact, and if one fluid is moving in this direction, the other one is in contact and is following. Therefore, they at the border, they have exactly the same velocity. What we are going to do in the next lecture is to basically, you see we have psi here that can be used here. We have the pressure that we can be used here. And then we combine the two equations together to figure out what is omega in our perturbation, in the solution of our perturbation, and see how this instability is going to arise, if it is going to arise at all. Okay? Good. Thank you very much, and see you next time.